welcome to the show. Finally, the Premier League is back, and it looked a lot like business as usual at the top, but it was a horror start for Frank Lampard. Joining me to revel in Chelsea's misery this week are Simon Plum, Jack Mabeer and Victor Harry Maguire Waters. Kia ora. Well, I think we should start on that, actually, because, Jack, you weren't here last week, but Victor was talking a massive game. Oh, Harry Maguire's not going to get off the bench. He's overrated.
thanks for keeping the bench warm for me, guys, last week. Much what we thought Harry Maguire might do as well. Unfortunately, he came on and had a fantastic debut for Man United.
Insanity, mate.
Well, let's get on to the Man United result in a minute, because maybe flattered them just a little bit. They play well, but maybe just a little bit, four goals, I don't know. But let's start off with City, and we're just right back into it. There you go. Nothing's changed in the off-season.
Yeah, I mean, it was an exciting start to the season, wasn't it? Bags of goals, lots of enthusiasm, optimistic teams, maybe venturing a little bit too far, against some of these bigger sides like City and Liverpool. But I thought City just looked totally dominant, I don't know how, if you're an opposition manager now, I don't know what you'd look at and think is a weakness in City's team that you can exploit, that you can actually kind of try and get a result or, snatch a draw or something. They're just, they take players out, they bring players in. They had their new midfielder, Rodri, might have got caught in the ball a couple of times during that match, but looked class, looked like he just slotted in, like he'd been playing for them for ages. And it's very scary.
Yeah, Sterling's hungry.
Well, that was the thing. We haven't even mentioned Sterling yet, the guy that scored a hat-trick and probably could have had more. Jose Mourinho had an interesting thing to say after the game. He said they're four favourites for the title: City, Chelsea, and I can't remember who else he said, but he also said
Liverpool.
Sorry, how could I forget?
Yes.
But he said the fourth team was Man City B, and you look at that bench and just go, wow, this is an outstanding team with quality absolutely everywhere, and they showed that.
100%. Yeah. West Ham actually started off all right first half, but then they just completely got steamrolling. City had a couple disallowed, and then when you bring on someone like Aguero as a sub, I mean, it's just lethal. It's kind of damage limitation, really. You're going into that game and a draw is a massive result.
If you're managing City, do you get concerned at all about, peaking or anything like that at the stage? I mean, obviously you want to come out and make a statement early on, but when you're looking at the season as a whole, it is a grueling, you've got months of work ahead. Do you just try and manage things a little
bit? Yeah, I think the advantage that City have, is that they have that big squad, and then they can rotate players through the team easily. That's probably an advantage they have over Liverpool, actually. We're a little bit sort of short on numbers in certain key positions.
Yeah.
Whereas City can bring in, essentially, as you say, like the B team or fresh players through all the time and just keep that intensity up.
Well, Liverpool had a great first half. I mean, it wasn't a bad second half, but, I mean, the fact that Norwich can now say they won the second half against Liverpool, it's like this weird little sort of moral victory. But they came out pretty bloody strong as well.
Oh, I think there are plenty of positives. I think Origi scoring, that's another, a positive thing to see. Firmino doesn't fire, though. Firmino does score. And Mane wasn't there, of course, so good to see, those players step up, of course, after last season. Champions League final, semi-final, so
they look like they'd not been away, really.
Business as usual.
Yeah, it's like the same pace, and I guess that's the familiarity that, you get from not bringing in any big signings over the summer and things like that. But I think the worry might be as the season draws on.
It's just that squad depth, eh?
Yeah, those players getting tired. They've had busy years, most of them. They've been playing in international tournaments and things like that. So they're very sharp at the moment. It's just whether they can keep that kind of level up, into the later months of the season.
And the other worry is Alisson, obviously, out injured now for four to six weeks.
Yeah, it's like a month, right? Yeah.
And you were talking about depth and, the new guy. He might be able to plug a hole there, but Alisson was a massive factor in why Liverpool did so well last season, and they will miss him.
Yeah, I mean, he gives a lot of confidence to the team because they know that they can rely on him if they need to, whereas this new guy, he's only been there a week, I think, and they don't really know much about him, haven't played with him before, so it could be testing for the defence, these next few weeks. Mm.
How do you think Frank Lampard felt after the weekend?
Like crying. I feel a little bit sorry for him. They were better value than a 4-0 defeat, for sure. They played pretty well. Mm. It was 1-0 for a long time, and really at half-time, Chelsea could have been 2-1 up.
Mm. Yeah.
In fact, until the second goal went in, they conceded 2 in 2 minutes, two-thirds through the second half. And it was just capitulation at that point, unfortunately. But United were good, but Chelsea weren't that bad.
Yeah,
I agree with you, Jack. I think the scoreline did flatter United quite a bit. And on another day, it could have been a draw at least, for Chelsea, maybe a bit more. But it's embarrassing, really, to start off your first game with what is essentially a thumping.
Victor, well, sorry.
Yeah, no, no. Well, I was just going to say, you know, Chelsea hit the post twice. That could have completely changed the complexion of the game.
Yeah.
In saying that, I think United were the better team and they were far more efficient, and Rashford looked fantastic. And Wan-Bissaka, one of the other defenders, new defenders for United, I thought was outstanding as well.
Well,
here we go. Here we go.
No, I just, it was interesting to me to see Harry Maguire off the bench, actually.
Yes.
How did you think he went, Victor?
Well, look, I'm not going to do a Paul Merson and apologise for ripping into Harry Maguire.
I think you should, straight down.
No, absolutely not. No, look, Maguire. I'm sure he is with his $80 million price tag, pound price tag. No, look, I thought Maguire, you know, he did what was expected. I don't think he was outstanding in any sort of. But the thing for me is, I don't think Maguire improves that squad in any way. I don't think, and that's what I was trying to get across. I think he came a little hot.
First episode of the new season, Victor came a little hot last week.
Well, you know, I had to say something. But look, you know, we'll see what happens. It's a long season. Yeah. One game, hard to judge.
Guys, a few questions still about the use of the VAR technology as well after that first round. We'll discuss that in a couple of minutes when we return. So City dominant 5-0 over West Ham, but still some questions about the use of that VAR technology. I mean, a couple of decisions going either way with it. It sort of feels like a lottery a little bit.
Yeah, I think, you know, it does get those decisions right, but it's sort of almost a bit too precise, isn't it, in some circumstances. It takes a little bit of the joy out of the spectacle, because I think we saw on a couple of occasions there in that City game, players that were millimetres offside.
Like 1 millimetre?
Yeah, like Sterling's shoulder was just slightly in front of the defender. And you just think, I guess the technology be that reliable? Can we definitely say, beyond a shadow of a doubt, that he was definitely in front of him? And also, what sort of advantage do you get from being a millimetre in front of another person? You know, it seems a little bit too good, almost.
I think when it comes down to those sort of situations, you've got to give the benefit of the doubt to the attacker. And I think just for the spirit of the game and everything, I just think you take a lot out of the game, especially like a millimetre. Like, how do we know how accurate that is? Could there be, what's the margin of error? I just feel like you're taking a bit out of the game.
Because, I mean, at the moment, it is a lottery. Like, right, and that's not necessarily a bad thing. If we all agree that the technology is probably not quite precise enough to judge a millimetre, I mean, that can be the difference between your shirt blowing in the wind or whatever. Yeah. You know, but it's not as though anyone is manipulating the technology to benefit any certain side. We think.
Yeah, you'd hope so.
Yeah, we think. But so, you know, so my point is that the lottery kind of benefits everyone and disadvantages everyone equally. But like you say, you really want to see, for the sake of the game, the benefit of the doubt going to the attacking side.
Yeah, and you kind of feel like it's maybe kicked in the defender's favour now a little bit. With Sterling one, sorry, the millimetre, I mean, that's going to depend on the moment of impact on the pass. So if you're going to cut it right down to a science, how fast is that ball going to make a millimetre's difference? It's impossible to tell. Mm-hmm. But as Jack says, like, it's actually getting things right in the most part. The debate is around the accuracy of it. But as long as it's consistent, there's no problem with it. It just feels, it's like watching cricket at times. You're watching these goals go and you think, is it going to stand or is it going to get ruled out? It's a little bit odd.
Yeah.
They've kind of tried to speed up that process, haven't they? The referral process.
Yeah.
To make it quite streamlined so people aren't sat around for ages. I think in the Wolves game, there was sort of a two and a half minute delay.
Yeah.
Something like that, where they decided whether it was a goal or not and they had to review all the footage. If it's not obvious straight away, it feels like maybe the advantage needs to go.
Do you think maybe they go about that? They just need to consider the way they present it to us as football fans. I think of something like tennis and how Hawkeye's become this, you know, it's an event in itself. Wait, as everyone goes, to wait and see if a ball is in or out. I wonder if maybe they could just fiddle around the edges with the presentation or something, and at the very least make sure that it's still a spectacle.
Yeah, and I guess with Hawkeye it's sort of, there's a definite line there, isn't
there?
It's very easy to see. Maybe
it's black and white,
maybe that technology is more advanced perhaps than what they're using for VAR, and it's sort of it's certainly got more
experience.
VAR has more moving bits.
It's been
used more. I think there's still a lot of teething problems with VAR. There's still a lot of issues and things to be sorted out. So I think with time it will get better and more streamlined. But yeah, Hawkeye's been around for years and it's at a good place now.
I think the main thing is it will do away with any over injustice in the game. So say if there's a shot that hits a bar and is it over the line or not, it will get rid of that stuff, which, you know, when there's so much money on the line, relegation, titles to be won, That's crucial, and that's the main thing. What we saw over the weekend with these kind of 1 millimetre differentials, that's kind of an unfortunate byproduct, I think. But the big decisions where people get wronged, that's going to get cleaned up.
Yeah, what? And I guess it takes a little bit of the wind out the sails of pundits as well, doesn't it? Because there has been a lot of discussion among pundits about whether a decision was right or wrong, but now we just know, don't we?
Yeah. Hey, what do you guys make of the newbies, the lowbies in the league? I mean, Norwich would be kind of happy, at least with that second half performance. Sheffield got a point. Villa went terrible.
Yeah, I thought they all came up and they had a good go, to be honest. Yeah, you know, Tottenham had to rely on a couple of late Harry Kane goals to get a result.
Harry Kane against Villa.
And Norwich had a right go at Liverpool. In fact, Liverpool haven't really conceded goals at Anfield much at all last season. I think there was only a handful. So to actually score at Anfield is actually quite a good achievement these days.
And good old Burnley with a big win. Chris Wood scored, but VAR.
Bloody VAR.
Took it away from him. So look, he looks like he's combining well with Ashley Barnes again this season. So
Okay, let's turn our attention to Europe now. We still have the European transfer window open, the English transfer window closed for now. Do you think we're going to see Pogba move?
Well, I think there's maybe one or two big moves left in this transfer window, and it takes one big move to sort of function for another one to happen. So I think we're going to see Neymar move.
Most definitely.
Back to Barcelona.
Most definitely.
I'm just back to Barcelona. Yeah. I'm so sick of Neymar. I think Neymar is overrated. He's look. I'm not going to pull a Victor Valentino.
What is he on the bench?
He's a talented footballer, but you know he leaves Barcelona because he wants the Palme d'Or, and then he the Ballon d'Or, he just seems like he's more trouble than he's worth at times.
Yeah, he's bang average.
I wouldn't say bang average.
You know what I mean? There's something about his attitude, you know, that
It's all about Neymar, absolutely. Oh. And the thing is, there's reports that he's talking to both Real Madrid and Barcelona. Yeah. So if the deal with Barcelona falls through, he's going, well, I'm happy to go to Real Madrid. Yeah. Mm. We'll see what happens. Barcelona officials are in Paris today negotiating a potential move. Mm. He's apparently desperate to come back. Out of his what they call the golden prison in Paris, where he's coveted and paid squillions, but yet.
What was that deal worth when he went to PSG? Like 222
million euro buyout clause.
Wow.
Because he wanted to get out of the shadow of Messi, and here we go back to Barcelona.
Yeah. Well, and he's in the shadow of Mbappe.
Yeah, I know. So. I know. You know what I mean? There's something about him. I just think.
And I'll be interested to see how Barcelona fans react because he left very unceremoniously.
But the players are quite keen to have him back.
Yeah,
he's quite popular on the team, and
apparently Messi's been calling the president saying, "Get him back here. I want him on the team." So,
but you could see Phil Coutinho moving out of Barcelona.
Well, he's part of the deal apparently. £100 million plus Coutinho.
As a Barcelona fan, would you want Neymar back?
On his knees and apologising. Yes, I would.
Apologising
personally to every he'll single Barcelona.
He'll do it as soon as you do it for last. let's look at the Kiwis quickly. You mentioned Chris Wood had a goal disallowed by the VAR. Winston Reid didn't even make the squad. What about Sarpreet Singh singing?
Not his finest hour, but you know, as initiations go, probably good on him.
I thought he looked like he's settling into life in Munich rather well, really, and like all those teammates were kind of having a laugh.
An appropriate song too. Justin Bieber's "Baby" was not, you know.
Did he pick it?
I would just love to know the process for something like that, whether or not he does get to pick it or whether or not they just pick something out of a hat. It's lucky you got that and knocked Dr. Dre, you know. No, but it is. I mean, he didn't get on in their cup game this week, but he seems to be fitting in.
There is talk that he will potentially be in the first team more often and maybe, you know, training with them more this season. I think they're still trying to figure out where his place is and what he'll be doing.
And still some transfer rumours that he might be joined by Gareth Bale as well.
That's another one. Apparently his agent has rubbished that. He's adamant he's going to be staying at Madrid and outlasting Zidane, which, by the form that they've been playing in pre-season, could happen.
Mm. Yeah, but if Pogba goes to Madrid, does that mean Bale has to move? Yeah.
Well, I don't think Pogba to Madrid is happening anymore, to be honest. Okay.
You heard
it. That's dead in the water. I think that's dead in the water.
What about Harry Maguire this week?
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say, if we're taking Victor's predictions, watch the space, because Pog will be gone.
Victor the predictor.
Yeah, there you go. Oh, very good. Hey, thank you so much, guys. Really appreciate it. Simon Plum. Victor Waters, Jack Mabea. That's it for today. We'll be back next week. And remember, TVNZ FC is available on One News Now, Facebook, YouTube, and as a podcast in all the usual places. Hey, Coordinator.